Miho is a right-wing thinker with considerably modest Indian cultural values. He has never held any government post in his life, nor is he associated with any organization. All his videos are original and creative.
In continuation of my talks with you, today I'm going to talk about the Marxist interpretation of wealth. Like everything in Marxism is basically propaganda and spurious stuff. Even the distribution of wealth, as they put it, is not really accurate, absolutely. So if you talk to any Marxist, the first thing they'll come and tell you is that 1% of the population of the world owns 75% of his wealth. And 1% of the population of India owns 60% of the wealth. And 1% of the population of America owns 50% of the wealth. This is spurious propaganda stuff. It's not true at all. Because let's examine it more closely. First of all, the definition of wealth. The definition of wealth is just personal wealth. That's why it comes. It looks like that. But the wealth of a country is far more than that. The rivers flowing through the country is the wealth of the country. The natural deposits, mineral deposits, that is the wealth of the country. The hydroelectric power, potential hydroelectric power, that's another wealth of the country. Of course, this is a natural wealth, but it does count. It does count quite a lot. In fact, it is said that the next wars, big wars, will be fought because of water, because of rivers. So rivers are a wealth of the country. Then you have natural, you have man-made stuff like the sewage systems. You have water. You have roadways. You have canals. You have, this is all wealth of the country. You have canals. You have roadways. You have utility distribution of electricity. This is all wealth of a country, and it doesn't. It's not been put down into the total wealth of the country of the world. So if you, and the army is also wealth. The government buildings, the monuments, what is the price you pay on the pyramids of Egypt? Because actually the pyramids of Egypt is a revenue earner. A lot of tourists go out there to gawk at the, I don't know why should they do that, but a lot of people go to look at pyramids, and the Egyptians make a lot of money out of it. India makes a lot of money out of Taj Mahal. And it's a wealth of India. There's no doubt about that. That the Taj Mahal is part of the wealth of India. And if you put it into dollar terms, it is quite huge actually. So, if you include all this man-made and natural wealth into the total wealth of the country, then the figures don't stand. When you say that the 1% of the 1% of the population owns 75% of the world, absolutely not true. We'll come to 10 to 15% only. The wealth of the world will increase manifold. Even your oceans, like they have an economic zone of 100 kilometers. So within the 100 kilometers, there is a lot of exploitable stuff, and you get a lot of valuable resources from that. Isn't that the wealth of the country too? Because if it's overexploited, then you have licenses and you control it. So that is the wealth of the country. If you have got an ocean full of fishes and oysters and all, that's the wealth of a country. It counts a hell of a lot. In fact, I've been to one of these places in the Sundarbans. And they produce just three things there. They produce bamboos, which are fantastic actually, and then they produce rice, and they produce fish. The amount of rice they produce is equal to the amount of fish they produce. So that is not wealth. I mean, if rice is produced out of the fields, that is wealth. Then why aren't the small rivers and rivulets flowing through the system? That is not wealth. That is also wealth. So, if you include everything, nobody, I mean, are you saying that 1% of the population owns 75% of the rivers? They don't. It's a default setting. If nobody owns it, the government owns it. And the government can actually license it out if they feel like it. So, and by the definition, if you have the definition, then actually a lot of countries are wealthy countries but poor. For example, Venezuela. Venezuela has got, I mean, they got gold. They got huge amounts of gold deposits. They are not exploiting it. One of the biggest deposits of crude oil also. And they are not exploiting. So they are a poor country, but wealthy and a poor country. And it happens in real life also. There are a lot of people who got a lot of wealth, but they live like poor people. It happens. This thing also happens. Anyway, and then you have Nepal, which has got a huge amount of hydroelectric power, but they don't use their that wealth that they have for political reasons. Then you have say Afghanistan. Afghanistan is a country with a lot of wealth in natural resources, minerals, copper, gold, coal. Which they are unable to do it because of so many reasons. So, Afghanistan is a wealthy country that is poor. So, if you include all that, then the Marxist statistics do not stand. It's stupid to say that 1% of the people own 75% of the world. Absolutely stupid. If you look at the army, army is a huge man-made resource. The motorways, the railways, all these are man-made resources. The sewage system. If you any civilized city, any civilized city should have a proper sewage system and a proper water supply and electric supply system, and that costs a lot of money. So you look at the city and you value its buildings, but you don't value its real infrastructure. That is the streets and the sewage and the water supply and the garbage disposal systems. These are all the wealth of this place. And if they didn't have that, then it won't be a civilized city. A lot of cities don't have it and they're not civilized. So, if you include all that into the wealth of the world, then in the end you'll find out that actually people own only 10 to 20% of the wealth. But this is another part of the story. Like I told you, it's all spurious and it's all propaganda stuff. So when you're looking into the wealth of the individuals, you are including in it the means of production. So, if you take a guy like Bill Gates, he's one of the richest guys in the world. But a lot of his wealth is tied into Microsoft. So, if he sold off that wealth, he won't have the means of production in his hands. And Microsoft is Microsoft because of his personality. So, it is a big his big contribution to the world. Nobody denies that. And he uses 90% of his income in charitable causes. There's no doubt about that. I mean, I can't understand him, but he's a very different type of person. So, how can you take his ownership of
wealth?
He can sell it. He can sell it and then convert it into wealth. Yes, that's true. But if he converts into the wealth, he's no longer the owner of Microsoft. And it has happened before. A lot of people have actually converted their means of production into wealth and they become wealthy persons. But till that time that they own the means of production and they run it, then it's not wealth for them. So if you take out the means of production from the equation, then the ownership of wealth becomes even 10%. So, actually speaking, the wealth of wealthy individuals in a place like the United States will be 10 to 15% only. In India, it might be a bit more because India is a different type of country. So, the concentration of wealth is way the Marxists put it. It is a spurious thing. It is not true at all. And then we are going to discuss wages exploitation too. Even that is spurious. It is not true at all. The Marxist interpretation of wages and exploitation is absolutely not true. And we'll come to it. There's no doubt. You just wait for my next talk with you. Till then, I thank you for listening to this small talk. And I hope that you will listen to my next stops when I take the Marxist philosophy piece by piece and show it to you. It is simply leftist propaganda. It is not based on reality. It is not based on real facts. Thanks for listening in, and I would like you to actually go to my channel and look at the other videos also.